session. Namaskar. Good morning to the participants from US and good evening to all of you in India. I welcome you all to the sixth session of the series of webinars on Mahabharata and Bhagavad Gita as hosted by Department of Philosophy, University of Delhi and Kamala Nehru College, University of Delhi. These webinars are being organized under the aegis of SPARK Project, which is a scheme for promotion of academic and research collaboration, an initiative of Ministry of Human Resource and Development, Government of India, with its coordinating partner as Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur. The title of our project is Yoga Consciousness in Mahabharata and Bhagavad Gita, an ethical value for societal and political well-being. We are working as a team for this project with Professor Bala Ganapati Devarakonda as the head of the Department of Philosophy at University of Delhi. He is the Indian principal investigator for this project. He's always there with us for every session, but today he's occupied in another international session which is being held at the same time. So I'm doing his part of introducing and welcoming everyone. I, Geetesh Nirvan from Department of Philosophy, Kamala Nehru College. I'm the Indian co-investigator for this project. Our international investigators are Professor Vishwa Adluri from USA and Dr. Joydeep Bakshi from Germany. We have an extended team which consists of Jayashree Jha, Anmol Preet Kaur, Megha Kapoor, and Deepshika Sharma. Out of them, three of them are research scholars at University of Delhi, and one of them is a postgraduate student in the same department. As far as our project is concerned, it is a collaborative attempt to revisit the Indian epic to explore yoga consciousness as one of its underlying messages while understanding how dharma, as a result of yoga consciousness in Mahabharata and Bhagavad Gita, can well be interpreted for political and societal well-being. This project is a journey through the roadmap of yoga consciousness to delve deeper into ancient Indian wisdom for reviving the concepts of social responsibility and value embeddedness, as well as search for answers to the question of right action while portraying how yoga consciousness in form of equanimity and equality in Mahabharata and Bhagavad Gita emerges as an ethical ideal. Well, the series of webinars are a humble attempt to make the various aspects of Mahabharata reach the diverse audience who are holding interest in the study of Mahabharata, the very epic. For today's session, we have with us Professor Ruth Wanita from University of Montana, USA, to deliver the address on gender and sexuality in dialogues between male and female sages in the Mahabharata. Professor Ruth is a very well-known name for all of us who have been reading and studying the feminism in India. The article authored by her with the title "The Self is Not Gendered, Sulabha's Debate with King Janaka" is a distinct piece of research that one encounters in the course of feminism as designed for the students pursuing graduation in philosophy at University of Delhi, and I'm certain in many other universities too. This write-up has actually prompted and initiated many younger scholars to explore Mahabharata, not just from the perspective of prominent women characters in it, but also to look at it from the perspective of many other women who are epitome of knowledge and philosophical wisdom. Well, we are very honored to have you with us, Professor Ruth. She's online here pretty early in the morning at USA to share her insights on gender in light of Mahabharata. Before I hand over to Jayashree to give a kind of a formal introduction to Professor Ruth, I would like to request all of you to keep your videos off and sound muted so that we can have a seamless flow of this session. As far as questions are concerned, nearly after 30 minutes of Professor Ruth's address. You can post the questions in the chat box. We are going to be collecting them, and we'll try to take them as many as possible during that 30 minutes of Q&A session. And at the end of the session, we will be requesting you all to switch on your videos so that we can have group pictures. Now, I hand it over to Jayashree to introduce Professor Ruth.
Thank you, Dr. Gitesh. Today we have with us Dr. Ruth Vanita, professor at the University of Montana, former associate professor at Miranda House and Department of English, University of Delhi. Dr. Vanita is the author of many books and over 60 articles on gender and sexuality in Indian and British literatures and Bombay cinema. Her first novel, Memory of Light, appeared from Penguin this month. Dr. Vanita has just completed her next book on gender, species, and dharma in the Apex. She was founding co-editor of Manushi, India's first nationwide feminist journal, and worked on it for 13 years. She has translated many works from Hindi and Urdu to English. She divides her time between Missoula, Montana, and Gurgaon. Thank you, ma'am, for accepting our invitation to shed some light on a very paramount topic, gender and sexuality in dialogues between male and female sages in the Mahabharata. Thank you once again, ma'am. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Thanks for being here. Thanks to the philosophy department for inviting me. In this time when one is unable to travel, it's great to be virtually back at my alma mater, Delhi University, where I studied philosophy as an undergraduate and then completed my PhD in English from Delhi University. Parts of today's lecture appeared in my article, Male-Female Dialogues on Gender, Sexuality and Dharma in the Hindu Epic, as chapter 13 of the Bloomsbury Research Handbook of Indian Philosophy and Gender, edited by Veena Howard and published in 2019. And these materials will also appear in greater detail in my forthcoming book on the epics, which is now under review by a publisher. Okay, so today I'm going to focus on a dialogue in the Mahabharata between the male sage Ashtavakra and the female sage Disha. Scholars have neglected the philosophical debate in this narrative, perhaps because the magical dimensions of the narrative have led them to classify it as so-called mythology. As I will show today, the dialogue addresses philosophical questions about the nature of men, women, desire, the body, and marriage. Andrew Nicholson has pointed out that some scholars have perpetuated a bias against narrative texts like the epics and Purans, considering them mythological and therefore lacking in philosophical rigor. But as he demonstrates, pre-modern Hindu philosophers readily quoted from these texts, that is from the epics and Purans, to support their arguments. So these are philosophical poems. The epics are philosophical poems, at least that is how I approach them. The Mahabharata includes accounts of the doctrines of various schools of Indian philosophy, detailed accounts of, say, Sankhya and of yoga. So I think it's a mistake to construct a divide between narrative texts and philosophical texts. Legal texts are another matter. To come to Ashtavakra, as you know, he gets his name from being bent in eight places, or what today we might call disabled. I have written about his disability and other aspects of his story elsewhere, both in the Mahabharata and in medieval versions of the Ramayana. But today, the present story is about Ashtavakra as a young man, and there is no mention of his disability here. This is because in some recensions of the Mahabharata, he is cured after he rescues his father. So this story appears in the Anushasana Parva of the Mahabharata, when Yudhishthira asks Bhishma a series of questions about marriage. Yeah. Yudhishthira's first question is, why is it that in the hand-taking ritual, Pani Grahanaha, in a wedding ceremony, the spouses are instructed to perform dharma together, saha dharmaha? So Yudhishthira asks, why this idea of saha dharmaha? Is it accepted as true just because the ancient rishis laid it down as a rule? And then Yudhishthira says, if that is the case, I disagree. Viruddha iti me matihi. Which is very interesting because it shows that people were not considered heretics or blasphemers for differing from the ancient rishis. He says, I disagree, and he raises several objections to it. Okay, so what are Yudhishthira's objections to joint dharma and marriage? First, he makes the interesting point that couples rarely die together. So if dharma has to be joint, then what becomes of the survivor, right? His second point is that human beings, manusha, perform a variety of actions, karma, and each one person has to incur the fruit of their own actions, karma phalam. You can't be incurring the karma phalam of somebody else. Since human beings are very different from one another, how can marriage be a union for the joint practice of dharma? Now, these are meaningful questions about ontology. Ontology is the branch of philosophy which deals with the nature of existence. Marriage is a social and sexual arrangement in one lifetime, but each being has its own actions and own attachments, and each one moves from one life to the next at a different pace. So each person thus has his or her own swadharma. Now, what is swadharma? Very quickly, we know the swadharma is based on your position in life, right? But it's also, what we forget often is that swadharma is also partly based on vasanas. Vasanas are the tendencies from former lifetimes. So your vasanas from former lifetimes and also your actions from before marriage, all of these will shape your swadharma. So Yudhishthira's question makes sense. His other question about a widowed person, what about a person whose spouse has died? That also raises the question of the dharma of all those who are single. Now, these questions are not very different from questions which people ask today about marriage. So people today might wonder, does marriage help the growth and development of the spouses, the spiritual, intellectual, moral growth of spouses, or does it stifle it? What has marriage got to do with an individual's own self? Okay. So the second part of Yudhishthira's objection relates to gender difference. And this is based on a stereotypical negative view of women that some characters put forward in the Mahabharata, as well as in other texts. So Yudhishthira states that the Vedas say that women are anritaha, that is, they do not adhere to Ritha, they are opposed to Ritha. Ritha is the Vedic term for the cosmic order on which Dharma is based. Ritha, from which comes perhaps, may also be the root for the English word right. So it's the order of the universe. So Yudhishthira says that women are anritaha, opposed to ritha. And if women are inherently disordered in their behavior, opposed to ritha, then how can marriage be a union for the joint practice of dharma? Now Yudhishthira, of course, is mistaken here. The Vedas do not state that women are inherently opposed to ritha or to cosmic order. That's not a feasible idea. How can part of the cosmic order be inherently at odds with it, opposed to it? It doesn't make sense, yeah? Anyway, so Yudhishthira states that women are innately disordered and the implication is men are superior to women, right? So he asks, how can a man and a woman who are innately different, if one of them is opposed to Ritha, how can they fulfill dharma jointly? Now this question raises issues of equality. It also raises issues of likeness and difference, which I am more interested in a way. Because you can have a partnership between two people who are not equal, right? But the two partners must be alike in some way. Only two beings who are like one another can be thought of as sharing dharma. So this raises the question, how alike or how different are men and women? Yudhishthira's questions are somewhat similar to those that Aristotle raises in the Nicomachean Ethics. Aristotle claims that true friendship can exist only between those who have a likeness to one another. And therefore, the best friendship, he says, is between two virtuous men. Marriage, according to Aristotle, is a form of friendship in which the wife is an inferior partner who must be educated by her husband. Now, today, most people would not agree that women are inherently inferior to men, but many people, including some feminists, would argue that women are inherently different from men. And a few radical feminists would even claim that women are superior to men. Now, Yudhishthira's question sheds light, therefore, I would say, on the modern debate, the ongoing modern debate about psychological differences and similarities between women and men. How far are these differences innate, or how far are they due to training or upbringing or whatever? Yeah. Then Yudhishthira suggests, he says, then what is the meaning of this joint dharma and marriage? And he suggests there could be three different meanings because dharma has different meanings. First, the word dharma, in its original etymology, it applies to the inherent nature or the law of one's being, which necessitates a range of functions. Now, these functions are neither meritorious nor unmeritorious. For example, a common example is, it is the dharma of iron to sink and of wood to float. It doesn't mean one is better than the other. That's just the innate dharma, right? So Yudhishthir asks, is this the word dharma used in the context of marriage? Is it in this grammatical sense that we are using it rather than in a moral sense? The second meaning of joint dharma could be simply sexual pleasure, Yudhishthir suggests. It could refer to the fact that sex within marriage is a duty and also a pleasure that is in accordance with dharma. Is that the meaning? The third possible meaning, he says, could be to the dharma of producing children together. Now, here it should, of course, be noted that many people cannot produce children together, either due to age or to infertility or some other reason. Therefore, this third meaning that he is suggesting, it cannot apply to all marriages. Now, Yudhishthir asks Bhishma, which of these three meanings is correct? Bhishma does not answer the question directly. He often responds by telling a story. So he tells the story of conversations between a young male sage Ashtavakra and an elderly female sage Disha. The story shows how Ashtavakra's rigid ideas about sex and marriage change due to his encounter with an unusual independent woman of a kind that he has never met before. And Yudhishthir is left to get his answers from the story, deduce his answers from the story. Bhishma begins the story by saying that Ashtavakra loses his heart to sage Vadanya's daughter Suprabha the moment she looks at him. And he asks her father for her hand in marriage. As a precondition for their marriage, Vadanya tells Ashtavakra to go and meet the female sage Disha who lives in the Himalayas. Vadanya tells Ashtavakra that Disha is old, she is very fortunate, and she is established in Diksha. He also says that she is beautiful and attractive to the heart. In one version, he says she is like Shri, that is like Lakshmi. The reference to Diksha here shows, as other texts do, that women could also be initiated into Vedic studies. Yeah, that's by the way. So Ashtavakra sets out on this long journey to the Himalayas. He performs many rituals on the way. He meets various deities on the way. And one of the deities he meets is Kuvera, the god of wealth. Kuvera entertains him with a dance of apsaras or celestial nymphs. 19 of their names are actually given. And Ashtavakra is so charmed by their music and their dance that he spends a whole year there without noticing the passage of time. And Kuvera has to gently remind him of his mission. So he keeps going through a delightful landscape and he comes to Disha's dwelling, her house, which is wonderfully decorated. And there 7 beautiful girls greet him. Each one of them steals his heart as he looks at her. Manoharath. They steal his heart. The phrase here, Manoharath, is the same phrase as used about his falling in love with Suprabha, Manojahara. Okay, so it's the same phrase. So with great difficulty, he controls himself and he goes in to meet Disha. And Disha appears to be an old and decrepit lady. That night, Disha makes sexual advances to him, but she finds when she touches him that he is lifeless like wood. She then tries to verbally persuade him into having sex with her. She talks to him and she says, this union will be a reward for his austerities. She will gratify all his desires. She will bestow all her wealth on him and they will enjoy all pleasures, divine and human. Ashtavakra responds that he never approaches another man's wife because the scriptures forbid it. Now, this is a very odd response because neither Disha nor Vadanya nor anyone else has suggested that Disha is married. Disha has just told Ashtavakra that all the wealth that he sees belongs to her and she will give it to him along with herself. But he still assumes that she is married. This shows that much like Janaka in his conversation with the female sage Sulabha, Ashtavakra thinks that every woman has to be attached to some man. He just assumes that. Nobody has told him. Ashtavakra adds, he says to her, he is not interested in pleasure of any kind, and he is going to marry only in order to have children in a way that accords with dharma. Now, from reading so far, we know that his statement is untrue because we already know that he was attracted to Suprabha, he was attracted to the 7 maidens, and he does enjoy pleasure because he enjoyed the music and dance at Kuvera's house. So this is an interesting point because Ashtavakra seems to be saying that marriage is meant not for sexual pleasure, but for children. This addresses Yudhishthira's question, what is marriage for? Yeah. Now, Ashtavakra has virtually accused her of making adulterous advances. He's virtually saying that she's married and she's making advances to him. Disha could reveal that she's a single woman who is making advances to a single man, but she does not. Instead, to bolster his prejudices for the moment, she repeats the commonplace negative cliches about women. She says, women will do anything for sexual pleasure, even destroy their families, betray their birth families and their marital families, and faithful wives are extremely rare. Now, surprisingly, in answer to this, Ashtavakra now says, desire, karma, springs from taste or inclination, ruchiram. Now, this is an implicit admission that he has refused her advances, not because he is impervious to all desire, but because she is not to his taste, right? So he now asks her, what else can I do for you? And she requests him, please stay for a while and see how things develop at different times and places, deshakala. So he agrees to do that. Now we see the reality behind Ashtavakra's high-minded claims that he's impervious to desire and all this. All of the next day, he is tortured by worry, chintam santapta. He keeps looking at Disha, but he's unable to feel any desire because he's displeased by her looks, because she's old and he thinks ugly. Naramat, he doesn't feel any desire. And in a very powerful phrase, his vision is defeated by her form, repulsed by her form. Drishti rupa parajita. Yeah. Now, this is a step forward, I think, in his understanding of desire, because he now realizes that he's not really immune to desire. Rather, it's because she is old and ugly that he's refusing to have sex with her. It's not because he doesn't feel desire, but because she is not attractive to him. Now, in Hindu philosophy, repulsion is also a form of attachment. Yeah. So Ashtavakra's strong aversion to ugliness, like his earlier attraction to beauty, shows that he is not free from attachment. His rejection of Disha is not based on his freedom from desire, but it's based on her age and ugliness. As a scholar, Ashtavakra would be aware of this, and hence his anxiety, chintam santaptaha. That's why he's anxious. So the next evening, Disha starts giving Ashtavakra pleasure in various ways. She massages every part of his body with perfumed oil. She seats him on a splendid seat and she bathes him with her own pleasure-giving hands. I'm translating actual phrases from the text. Now, this is very similar. It reminds you of the Kama Sutra, where sexual pleasure is just one of many, many pleasures. We often make a mistake of thinking Kama is only sexual pleasure. No, Kama is every kind of pleasure and desire. Now, Ashtavakra, who had claimed to be indifferent to all pleasures, he enjoys all these pleasures so much of massage and sitting on the seat and bathing that the whole night passes without his noticing. He is amazed to see the sun rising. Similarly, the next day also passes unnoticed while he eats delicious food that Disha cooks for him. Yeah. The fact that he doesn't notice the passing of time shows that he experiences these pleasures very intensely, not mildly. Earlier too, in Kuvera's palace, he had not noticed the passing of time when he was engrossed by the nymphs dancing and singing. Time is experienced not as an absolute, but in relation to experience. Yeah, we grow old in time, but in moments of intense pleasure, time seems to stand still. Ashtavakra's eyes were repelled by Disha's aged appearance, but the senses of touch, taste, and smell are less affected than sight by the age of the person providing the pleasure. Yeah. So that Disha's hands give him pleasure when she massages him, hasta sukhena, when she massages him with perfumed oil or she cooks delicious food. Then her age doesn't matter that much. He's then given a lovely bed to sleep on. Now this list of pleasures that Ashtavakra enjoys, it overlaps a good deal with the list of pleasures that Bhishma, elsewhere in the Shanti Parva, says that women love. In this other passage of the Shanti Parva, Bhishma says, because women have powerful senses and are incapable of restraint, they enjoy, I quote, beds, seats, ornaments, food, and drink, unquote. Okay. So all these things, beds, seats, food, and drink, Ashtavakra's enjoyment shows that he's enjoying all these things. So he is not immune to pleasure. And secondly, it shows that women and men respond to the same pleasures, I think a very important point. When Disha again comes to his bed that night, now Ashtavakra changes his argument for refusing to have sex with her. He still refuses, but he gives a different argument. He no longer claims to be immune to pleasure, but he simply repeats that he cannot have sex with the wife of another person. Now this shows a step forward in self-knowledge, I think. It suggests that based on the previous night and day's experiences, he has realized that he is not indifferent to pleasure. So he doesn't say he's indifferent to pleasure. He just says, I cannot have sex with another man's wife. Now Disha replies, I am self-governed, Swatantra Asmi. This indicates that she is not married. Now Yashavakra can't understand this and he can't accept this. He states that according to scripture, a woman can never be self-governed, Swatantra or independent. Disha counters the rule. She replies in a different manner. She says, Ashtavakra, you are incurring adharma by refusing my request for sexual intercourse, methunam. Now, here she's probably referring to a text such as the Chandogya Upanishad, which instructs a man never to refuse a woman who comes to him requesting sexual relations. Now, these two rules, I would say, seem to contradict one another. If a woman can request sexual relations, as the Chandogya Upanishad says, yet a woman can never be independent, then how is that to work? You would reach a somewhat absurd conclusion that a woman who asks for sex must be instructed to do so by a man. That doesn't make any sense. So it must mean that the Chandogya Upanishad statement has a straightforward meaning. A woman can have agency in desire, and a man should yield to her agency. When Ashtavakra continues to refuse, Disha moves on from proposing sexual relations to proposing marriage. She now proposes marriage to him. She says that if Ashtavakra considers it wrong to have sex with one who is not his wife, she is willing to marry him. She uses the same term for the hand-taking ceremony that Yudhishthira had referred to in his opening question. She says, take my hand, panim grenishvame. She again adds that she can propose marriage to him because she is self-governed. She governs herself, Swatantra. Now, note that Disha proposes marriage only as a concession to Ashtavakra when she finds that he is reluctant to have sex with her. But Ashtavakra continues to be bogged down in his academic idea that a woman cannot be independent. And he asks her, how has she come to be independent? He says, a woman should be under the protection of a father, a husband, or a son. He repeats that. So now what we see is that despite his great intelligence, Ashtavakra is stymied because the fact that he sees before him an independent woman who is without a father, husband, or son contradicts the abstract rule that a woman should have a father, husband, or son. When the academic theory, and I'm sure we all encountered this in our academic work, when the academic theory or formula contradicts the actual facts you see before you, which should you go by? Life itself proves that the abstract rule is untrue. The rule is a woman should be under the government of her husband, father, or son. But here is Disha in front of him who doesn't have those, and she is independent. Now, which to believe? Disha then tells him that she has been celibate since girlhood and is still a virgin. If singleness is a possible choice for a woman, and it is because the epics mention several single women, Disha is not the only one, then the idea of a woman always being under the control of father, husband, or son falls to the ground on a third score. A father would normally die before a daughter, and a celibate woman would most likely not have a husband or a son, so she would have to govern herself. It just follows from that, from the fact of single women. Ashtavakra now suddenly changes his stance. When she says that I am single, I've always been single, he changes his stance and he replies, as you are to me, so am I to you. The way the words are placed in this line indicates a balance achieved between the two of them. Yatha mama, tatha tubhyam, yatha tava, tatha mama. Okay. He thus acknowledges that as she had predicted, he has developed a liking for her after spending time with her. She asked him to wait and see what happens, desh and kal. Huh? And now he feels desire for her just as she does for him. Next, the story takes a very interesting turn. It raises the issue of how desire affects our perceptions of beauty and of age. And this is expressed as a series of questions that Ashtavakra asks himself, but does not fully answer. The text is a little bit cryptic or unclear here. It seems that Ashtavakra is now not talking to Disha, but to himself. He's asking, debating with himself. These questions leave the reader with further questions as to how Ashtavakra and Disha may have changed during this encounter. So in the epics, as you know, especially the Mahabharata, but in the epics in general, much of the epic unfolds through conversation, dialogue, and debate. And one of the questions I raise in my book is, how does that conversation change the people who are involved in it? Yeah. So Ashtavakra first asks himself the question, how has Disha become young and beautiful? His asking this question tells us that Disha has suddenly become young and beautiful. He is amazed and he wonders why she looked old earlier. Now he wonders what he should do now. and whether yielding to her, should he give in to her desire for sex or marriage or whatever, should he yield to her, would that be opposed to what Vardhanya intended him to do? Finally, he decides to hold on to his earlier decision and not to have sex even with the young and beautiful Disha, because he thinks that following my own desire at this moment does not seem good, so I'll stick to my resolution. The text doesn't tell us whether Disha actually does change from old to young and ugly to beautiful. We are only given Ashtavakra's own words as he puzzles about this matter. So there are several ways to explain what has happened. Has Disha changed her form to attract Ashtavakra? That's a possibility, because in the Sulabha story, we were told that Sulabha took on the form of one young and beautiful. So Disha might be just appearing to be young and beautiful. Or is it that Ashtavakra's view of her has changed because he now finds her attractive, right? He had already said, as you are to me, so am I to you. And then the change occurs. So was he already feeling desire for her and that is why she changes? At the outset, Vardhanya had told Ashtavakra that Disha is old, but is as beautiful as Lakshmi. But that is not how she initially appeared to Ashtavakra. So a third possibility is that she used her yogic powers at the start to make herself look ugly in order to prove a point to Ashtavakra. You just have to speculate here because the text doesn't explain. Was her ugliness a temporary apparition, or is her beauty a temporary illusion? This question draws our attention to various issues. So it draws our attention to the issue, what is beauty? To what extent is it in the eye of the beholder? Does it matter whether the beholder is male or female and the beautiful person is male or female? Also, are so-called ugliness and beauty stable, or do they change? Social ideas of what is beautiful and ugly, we know that changes, right? Everyone's physical appearance changes in time. Does our perception of physical appearance also change? To what extent is beauty related to youth is another question. Are all the young beautiful and are all the old ugly? All these questions are raised by this debate he has with himself. So as Sulabha points out in her dialogue with Janaka, bodies are always changing. Age and youth, ugliness, beauty are all temporary appearances. A body that appears young will later appear old, but a body that appears old and ugly may, in a certain light or to a certain person, appear young and beautiful. Right? So we are left with all these questions because the text doesn't really answer these questions, but it raises the questions. The most important element as far as gender is concerned is the relationship between desire and beauty. As long as Disha appeared old and ugly to Ashtavakra, he refused sex with her because he was not attracted. But he claimed that his refusal was based on disinterest in sex. That was his first claim. After he feels attracted to her, he starts seeing her as young and beautiful, but now he exercises self-restraint to refuse sex. In either case, however we read this, she has proved to him that desire develops between people not only because of youth and beauty, but because of other factors as well, such as the pleasures of touch, of taste, of conversation. Now he knows that desire, so in terms of Ashtavakra's training in what is desire, which is what his father-in-law, prospective father-in-law sent him to learn perhaps, he now knows that desire can arise for different reasons. He was attracted to Disha's young companions because of their youth and beauty, but he became attracted to Disha after getting to know her and spending time with her. So this is what Disha meant by saying, wait and see how things develop in time and place. Now Ashtavakra asks Disha, how is it that your form has changed? He tells her, don't say anything that is untrue, anritaha. The word anritaha is the same word which Yudhishthira used at the start to describe women as disorderly, right? Untrue, in his first question to Bhishma. So while we are reading the story, as often happens in the Mahabharata, you forget all about where the story started because you're carrying going it. So this word anritaha reminds the reader of the framing Bhishma Yudhishthira dialogue. It reminds us that that is the where it started. And it also reminds us that the Ashtavakra Disha story is being told to examine women's nature and to answer Yudhishthira's question about whether women and men are similar enough to be partners in dharma. That is the point, yeah? Disha does not answer the question about how she changed. Instead, she explained why she tried to seduce him. Her emphasis is more on her own motivations than on his. So his perception of her as changing from ugly to beautiful may not be very important to her. Now, this is important. Like, two people in the conversation have different motivations and they're more interested in their own ideas than in the other person's, right? So she tells him that she is the manifestation of the northern direction, hence her name, Uttaram Mam Disham. That explains her name, Disha, which literally means direction. But there is also a play on words here, because Uttaram Disham can also mean the higher or superior direction. Uttaram Mam Disham. Huh? She says that she was testing him, and he, so she explains that she was testing him and he overcame all the three worlds by sticking to his resolution. Now she adds that he has now witnessed woman's unsteadiness or agilities, three chapalam. Now chapala is not an entirely negative word. It can mean unsteadiness, frailty, or infidelity, but it can also mean agility, playfulness, and nimbleness, okay? It's one of the names of Goddess Lakshmi, to whom Vadanya had compared Disha. Chapala is one of Goddess Lakshmi's names. So Disha's use of the word is ambiguous. A lot in this text is ambiguous. Disha follows it up. She next says that old women too experience the fever of desire for sex. She actually makes that statement. She says, Methuna Jvaraha is the fever of desire. She says she made advances to him because of desire, kama, and his refusal was the best possible answer. She says that Vadanya sent him to her to be instructed, and she has accordingly instructed him. So she tells him he should now go and marry the chosen girl who will bear his son. And finally, she makes an unambiguous statement. And the unambiguous statement is, desire cannot be completely overcome in the three worlds. The word completely or entirely is very important. So desire can be restrained or partly overcome, but the word completely cannot be completely overcome indicates that desire keeps arising again and again, as is seen in the many stories of the celibate sages who are overcome by desire at the sight of a beautiful woman after years of meditation and asceticism, right? So Disha's motives for trying to seduce Ashtavakra were mixed. She had mixed motives. She was teaching and testing him, but she also felt desire for him. And the only unambiguous statement she makes is that sexual desire cannot be entirely overcome in the three worlds. So Ashtavakra then respectfully takes leave of her. He returns to Vadanya and he tells him that he has been to the north as instructed. He has met a Devi. He has listened to her teaching and he has come back. Ashtavakra then marries Suprabha and he lives happily, Mudataha, having got rid of agitation or Jvaraha. Jvaraha or fever is the same word with Disha used to describe the febrile desire for sex, Methuna Jvaraha. Having got rid of that, he lives happily. Okay, so now let me come to the question of desire, what the text says about that. Desire or kama is of course a god and is also one of the aims of life. Some texts state there are four aims of life, some state there are three aims of life, but in all texts, kama is one of those three or four aims of life. Desire is present at the creation and even the gods are susceptible to desire. Liberated beings pass beyond desire when they achieve liberation, but they do have to usually pass through desire in earlier phases or earlier lifetimes before they can go beyond it. So the point is that desire is not to be despised or underestimated. In the Gita, Krishna says that he, the divine self, is the kind of desire, the kama, that is not opposed to dharma. He also says that while in a body, a liberated person will experience desire that is in accordance with dharma, but will be able to restrain it as needed. Okay, so the desire in itself is then not negative. The task is to distinguish in each particular context which desires are based on dharma and which are opposed to dharma. And usually there is also more than one viable option in the matter of desire. So just to take this story, if Ashtavakra had chosen to respond to Disha's advances, this would not have been perhaps an entirely wrong choice, because it would have been in accordance with Chandogya Upanishad, which says that if a woman makes advances, a man should not reject them, right? But Disha says that he made the best possible choice by refusing, okay? So if one option is the best, it doesn't mean another option is the worst. It just means the other option would have been less good. So it's a kind of nuanced text here about desire. Okay, so come to the question of gender. Disha is a woman, and I think that is significant, that he's sent to a woman to learn, not to a man, about desire. She is not just any woman. She's an advanced sage and teacher. Vadanya sends Ashtavakra to her to learn about the nature of desire. And Ashtavakra needs to acquire this knowledge in order to be ready for marriage. Just as Socrates claims to have learnt about love from Diotima, a woman philosopher, in Plato's Symposium, so also Ashtavakra, an accomplished male sage, needs to learn from a woman before he gets married. It's also significant that Bhishma, who is highly evolved male sage and a lifelong celibate, he's the one who tells the story about a woman teacher to instruct Yudhishthira about the dharma of marriage. So indirectly, Disha, who is a celibate woman sage, becomes the teacher of Yudhishthira. Without this input from a female teacher, perhaps Yudhishthira's education as a king would be incomplete. And it's also useful to note that those who are in power, any kind of power, but especially like kings and rulers, have more opportunities to indulge the fever of desire. And they specially need to learn about how to restrain desire and how to fulfill it in appropriate ways. So to go back to Yudhishthira's questions about marriage. So we've talked about gender and desire. This is his question was primarily about marriage. He began by referring to three types of marriage. The first is marriage for reproduction alone. This is the kind of marriage that Ashtavakra refers to when he tells Disha that he has overcome desire and he wants to marry only in order to have a child. From other evidence in the story, we saw that this was false in his case. And one may wonder whether it is ever possible for a man to reproduce without experiencing at least some desire. The abstract ideal of a marriage aimed only at reproduction is contradicted by Ashtavakra's own behavior and also by Disha's statement that desire cannot be entirely overcome in the three worlds. So many people, of course, enter into marriage because it's socially expected and in order to have a child. This kind of marriage may produce delight and it may not produce delight. It is one option and it's not necessarily a bad one. The second type of marriage is for sexual pleasure and affection. This is the kind that Disha refers to when she proposes marriage in order to fulfill her desire. But it's important to note that she also states that she is devoted to Ashtavakra. It's not just for desire, it's also that she is devoted to him. In this type of marriage, desire precedes marriage and is accompanied by mutual affection and devotion. This type of marriage may or may not result in reproduction. Here, Disha appearing old and decrepit is important. As an old woman, she presumably cannot reproduce. But she wants to marry Ashtavakra not for children, she never mentions children, but in order to have a relationship with him. So Disha demonstrates the reality of old women as desiring agents. She states unambiguously that even old women experience desire. This shows that feelings of desire, affection, and devotions towards someone are good reasons to marry, even if one cannot reproduce or does not wish to reproduce. The third type of marriage is one in which one may reproduce, because of course reproducing is not in anyone's control, but also experiences joy. And this is Ashtavakra's marriage with Suprabha. He marries her with affection, Preeti, and lives with her in a state of delight, Mudita. Earlier, Suprabha was described as unrivaled in beauty, good qualities, and good behavior. So she's a fit partner for Ashtavakra. So the story doesn't definitely resolve the question of whether men and women are different or the same. That was one of Yudhishthira's questions, right? It does suggest that men and women are not as different as Yudhishthira imagined. Disha is a woman who is similar to a man in being independent. Like a man, she forthrightly expresses desire and she proposes marriage. And she has the last word in their dialogue. On the other hand, at various points in the narrative, Disha says, as Bhishma does elsewhere, that women desire sexual union above all and they'll destroy their family in their search for it. These negative comments about women could be taken to confirm Yudhishthira's initial statement that women are innately disordered. Okay, so the text provides these various possibilities. But then again, Ashtavakra is clearly just as susceptible to desire as Disha is, and perhaps more so, because her purpose was primarily to teach him, and her apparently negative comments about women can be read as ironic, as I have suggested. So we are left uncertain as to what exactly Disha thinks or feels. But the narrative unambiguously tells us that Ashtavakra is so carried away by pleasure produced by different women on different occasions that he loses track of time on more than one occasion. So this again shows that men and women are more alike than different with regard to desire and pleasure. Yeah? So by not fully resolving the question of sameness or difference, this dialogue is different from the dialogue between female sage Sulabha and the philosopher king Dharmadhwaja Janaka in the Shanti Parva of the Mahabharata. Sulabha, you remember, takes a young and beautiful form to visit Janaka, and Janaka is wonderstruck by her appearance and he asks her, who are you and whose are you? Like Ashtavakra, he assumes that a woman must belong to a man. Without waiting for her answer, Janaka then rebukes Sulabha and says that because she is young and beautiful, he doubts that she has brought her senses under discipline, niyama. Without directly referring to the dictum that a woman must always be protected by a man, Janaka here implies that a young woman should not be independent. And Sulabha's answer cuts directly to the nature of existence, to the nature of existence and therefore the nature of gender, as we have been talking about. She says that the question, who am I, can only be answered by first answering the question, what is? Okay, before I know what I am, I have to know what is, what exists. Her first statement is, bodies are all made of the same elements and are in constant flux. They are constantly changing. Since minute particles of the body are born and die every moment, and we know this to be scientifically true. She points out that a body is an accumulation of particles, and in this regard, one body is not different from another body. Just as dust and water become indistinguishable from each other when mixed together, so also the atoms of a body. These mixtures are not stable. They keep changing all the time. And she says, no one asks the particles who they are or whose they are. She points out bodies and minds are constantly changing every moment. Questions about who has come from where or who belongs to whom or who is going where are meaningless. All bodies and minds change in this way. There is no difference between male and female bodies and minds. And she says this constant change is perhaps the most important aspect of existence. So she asks, who then has come from where or where not? Whose is it or whose is it not? Where is it and where is it not? No particular body, and this includes all human, animal, plant, mineral bodies, no particular body belongs to anyone, but at the same time, each individual body is everyone's. Whose is it or whose is it not? Whose is it not means it is everyone's. One doesn't even possess one's own body. It follows then that no one can possess another's body. Therefore, the requirement from Sulabha's point of view, which is different from the Vidisha Ashtavakra dialogue, somewhat different, the requirement for a woman to be under the control of a father, a husband, or a son is based on an ontological impossibility. Okay? If we understand the nature of existence, we realize that we don't even control our own bodies. Only change controls the body and the mind. From the body and the mind, Sulabha moves on to the Atman or the consciousness manifested in all individual selves. Prakriti is the cause of all bodies and Purusha is the cause of all selves, regardless of gender. It follows that there is no difference between the non-material selves of existing beings. Atmanyev atmanatmanam yathatvam anupashyasi evam ev atmanatmanam anyasmin kam napashyasi. She asks him, yadyatmani parasminscham samatam adhyavasyasi atham mam kasi kasyati kimartham anupritchasi. Idam me syadidam neti dvandvair muktasya mekhala kasi kasya kuto veti vachane kim prayojanam. Okay, just as you see yourself in your own self, in the same way, why do you not see yourself in other selves? If you perceive sameness between yourselves and others, then why did you ask me who I am and whose I am? This is mine, this is not mine. O king of Mithila, if you are free from such duality, then what is the point of saying who are you, whose are you, where are you from? Right perception shows that a woman or anyone as an Atman cannot belong to anyone else, whether father, husband, son, anyone, because all individual selves are really manifestations of the same one self. Likewise, Sulabha shows the ultimate unreality of Varna and Jati, or what much later came to be called caste. Janaka assumes from her ascetic appearance that she's a Brahmin, and he objects to her entering into yogic union with himself, a Kshatriya. This union would be, according to him, an inter-Varna union. Now here he is confusing a yogic union with a sexual union. Perhaps because he himself is attracted to Sulabha, he notices her beauty and youth as the first thing about her, and he projects this onto her, blaming her for being young and beautiful. In my book, I examine in greater detail, forthcoming book, the question of non-sexual yogic union and the related questions of intimacy and consent, because she takes possession of him without asking his consent and he gets very annoyed, perhaps with some justification. Sulabha explains that different varnas and different ashramas are not really different from one another. Varnas do not attach to the self, so there is no question of their mixing or not mixing. Only those who think that the varnas are really separate from one another and that the body and self are the same, only such people would think that a yogic union is inappropriate because of difference in varna or ashrama, but a liberated person should not think this. So this is very important because it means that people of different varnas are not really different. It's a mistake to see them as different. The idea of the ultimate non-reality of gender and varna is of course not unique to Sulabha. It's found in many other texts and in the Mahabharata and many other places. It's found in the Shvetashvatara Upanishad, which defies the nature of Atman in this way, defines it. It is not female, nor is it male, nor is it neuter. It is joined with whatever body it takes. In the same Upanishad, the Supreme Self is addressed as dual gender, both feminine and masculine. You are woman, you are man, you are boy, you are girl, which is of course very common in prayers to various gods like Shiva. Yudhishthira's questions are general. So coming back to Yudhishthira, Yudhishthira's questions are general and abstract. Bhishma's answers are concrete and practical. Bhishma's story shows how ideas about gender and sex develop as we grow, as we age, as we acquire experience. it also reveals, this Disha Chakra story also reveals how emotional and intellectual growth occurs not in isolation, but in dialogue with others. So both the dialogues that I have discussed, and which I discuss in much greater detail in my forthcoming book, what they do is they bring Pravritti Dharma, the social dharma different for each self, into dialogue with Nivritti Dharma, which is the universal dharma of every being to achieve liberation from the cycle of rebirth. They also both directly address the Manava Dharma Shastra's dictum, which is repeated also in the Mahabharata, that a woman must always be under her father's, husband's or son's protection and must never be independent. From different perspectives, both the dialogues demonstrate the invalidity of this dictum. The Mahabharata thus contains many points of view on many questions, and it is left to readers to decide which point of view is most in accord with foundational philosophical concepts. Thanks. With regard to woman or man or anyone. Yeah.
I think it's like almost 9:15 in India. It's almost dinner time and a breakfast time for you, Professor Ruth. So we would like to conclude the session here. And I would like to say that you touched upon the concepts of agency, consent, choice, social dharma. Quite a lot of topics that we study within the within Indian philosophical context, as reflected in the Indian traditional dialogues that appear in Mahabharata, which definitely gives us greater insight as well as views, opinions, and ideas to look into Mahabharata from different types of lenses, not just be confined to looking at certain characters from certain perspectives, but to give a kind of a wider version to our understanding of the epic. I'm really thankful to you on behalf of the whole project team to have spared time early in the morning for us. And we are all looking forward to reading your forthcoming book, which I'm sure would open newer avenues of research for many, many younger scholars. Thank you for being with us. Thank you all the participants for supporting us with your presence, posting us. So we end the session and we wish all of you, safe and healthy time during this COVID-19 situation. We all stay home and stay safe and have many more webinars like this. Thank you, Professor Ruth, for being with
you. Thank you so much.
Namaskar. Good night to all of you in India and a happy day ahead for everyone in US. Thank you. Namaskar. Thank you.